affiliated radio stations, IMUS, St. Louis, Missouri, 1260 WIBB, Abilene, Texas, Talk of the Town, 106.3. Join the IMUS network for the first time just the other day, Monday's program. And here's the rest of that story. Abilene and St. Louis making that agonizing decision to pay all of that money for some morning humor. Well, the joke's on you. What you heard Monday, Abileners, St. Louisans, that was as good as it gets. Oh, I know, appalling. And leaving WIBV and 106.3 unable to say what Paula said to the president that dark, dark day. I'm not a sucker. Page two. Here we go again, sickened citizens. Another round of Ira Reiner and Roger Cossack and the terminally dreadful Greta Van Susteren. Yeah. Babbling barristers plying the palaver profession, parasitically preying on perversion because O.J. the sequel is going down. You know what real justice in this case would be, Sodbuster? O.J. in a Ginzu frenzy, locked in a room with every chattering shyster and least legal loser we've come to hate so over these many months. Yeah. To paraphrase our 42nd president, Greta, you make my stomach turn. Here's my gavel. Kiss it. Page three.
No.
Say now, on the subject of matters litigious, cow pie pal, what in goodness name am I hearing about one of TV's most popular celebrity chefs? Well, one of the lesser-known concoctions, I bet, of the frugal gourmet, the PBS fella, Jeff Smith, oh, you know him, graying, beard, apron, has that lad on his cooking show set who looks like he might have too much colander and not enough ladle, so to speak. A lawsuit says Chef Jeff, who's a minister, mind you, once burned the good book for a cookbook that read as follows. Soak two teenage boys in alcohol, heat, and eat. Page four. Are you ready for a real horror story, fear-filled friend? Our president is working on next week's State of the Union address. Where's the terror? Press Secretary McCurry says Mr. Clinton's speechwriting team is the same that helped craft, get that, craft his inaugural speech. I don't know who was on that team, idiom idiot, but I suspect Tommy Hearns, former Vice President Dan Quayle, Ice-T, and the president of the Oakland, California School Board. Oh, Ebonics had to cancel that big promotion, you know. Wanted to enhance the image of black English. Every state was to submit a beauty pageant contestant to become Miss Ebonics, but they couldn't find the young lady willing to represent Idaho. Paul Harvey, good day.
We're talking with Tim Russett, who is the Washington bureau chief for NBC News and the host of Meet the Press.
Paula Jones, I have the solution.
All right.
You be the stand-in for Bill Clinton.
Yes.
The only problem would be when it came to the deposition with Deidre, and the judge asked her if you had any distinguishing characteristics.
Yeah.
What would she say?
I don't know. We'd have to ask her, I guess.
Your Honor, it's like a small, squishy little button.
Your radio sounds funny in the morning. You're listening to Imus in the morning.
But Samir Sadawi, the paper's news editor, insists Al Hayat has a reputation for fairness.
We don't know who did it. Whoever did it is an enemy of the Arab world.
Shut up and drive.
You gotta get some help, I'm telling you.
She said, I'm going Hawaii to decorate our home. So you feel more at ease here, and you won't need to roam. We'll take out the dining room table. Put a bar along that wall, and a neon sign will point the way to our bathroom down the hall.
Windy, 25 degrees.
Yeah.
This report's brought to you by the Kaufman Fund. Investors, pay attention. Kaufman Fund is the top-performing aggressive growth fund since the market low of 87. Call 1-800-MUTUAL-97 for information. Mary McNichol for the Beltline Technonics, Mobile Fan Highway Patrol.
Coming up on 21 FAR, and I am Imus Away. Allabody Express winter sale ends on Friday.
In the morning, trying to express with my daddy.
Say, makes the dribble. Fires a three at the buzzer. Here it is! It's over. This one is history, and the Celtics fall short once again.
Another Boston loss to New York. Good morning, Mike Breen with sports. Spencer Ross, the call. WEEI in Boston. Knicks defeat the Celtics for the 18th straight time. 109-107 victory at the Garden last night. A courageous effort from John Starks. 17 points off the bench, despite playing with a painful shoulder injury but Stark says he must play.
We don't have any time, you know, to lick our wounds right now.
No licking right now.
No.
Just winning for the Knicks.
Yeah. Get the sportscasters to lick you.
That would be great.
Meanwhile, at the Meadowlands...
Do we have a deal with Adidas? Why are we wearing the Adidas hat?
It's just the first one I grabbed. I was a little late.
All right.
Meanwhile, at the Meadowlands...
Grab an Autobody Express hat next time, I think.
It's in the wash.
Oh, okay.
Grab this.
Losing for the New Jersey Nets. Cleveland beat them 84-62, lowest point total ever for New Jersey. And Coach John Calipari advocated violence afterwards.
You get it to six. You gouge the other guy's eye out to win the game.
League officials certainly won't be happy with that. A fine perhaps coming for Calipari. NFL news, Mike Ditka, officially named coach of the Saints. 57-year-old Iron Mike hasn't coached in 4 years, but he's ready to go right now.
Our goal is to win. It's not to win later. It's to win now.
Unfortunately, the season is over right now. We'll have to wait until September.
Well, he understands that.
Yeah,
I wouldn't put it past him.
Well, but when the season rolls around, Ditka has a plan for his offense.
We're going to learn to run the football before we learn to pass it.
Says they will not attempt to pass for the first 8 games of the season until they learn to run that football, and then they'll throw some passes after that.
You have to wonder, how do these athletes wind up in the National Football League if you have to teach them everything?
I don't know.
You would think that they would know that.
Teach them to run?
Most of them have spent 4 years in college.
Yeah.
Playing football. That's why they wound up in the National Football League.
High school football?
Yes.
Sure.
So why would you...
I don't know.
I can't answer that, I mean.
Go back to square one and teach them to run the football and then teach them to pass. I mean, what's the point?
A winter league?
Tiny little
do you
football
understand
people?
That?
No, I don't.
No.
Perplexing,
no.
I imagine.
It's 23 after the hour. And here now, Media Watch, a malicious roasting of innocent media agencies and personalities by the Dean of Broadcast Journalists, Walter Cronkite.
So many zaps, so little time. Return with me now to January 23rd and 24th, days filled with the events and individuals that really torque you off. First this evening, Jerry Adler, nondescript scribe for Newsweek magazine, whose business card reads, Senior Editor.
Yeah.
This old, antiquated, desiccated disseminator of information knows senior editors, Mr. Adler, and you are no senior editor. In fact, looking over an unfortunate letter you wrote to the host of this program, the I-Man, you are in desperate need of an editor, noting here the wholesale absence of entire words and phrases that make your sentences read as though you were a product of the Oakland, California, I don't need no mother f***ing linking verb school system. You suggest in your letter that you'd like to profile the I-Man, and in the same breath, say you're unable to guarantee it would be the Newsweek cover piece. May I presume the I-Man's reply to your generous offer, then? Stop using Newsweek stationery and stop breathing. Yours will not be among the great minds of politics to be probed by the I-Man in the upcoming PBS Great Minds series.
Yeah.
Secondly, this evening, let us consider the new prominence of the NBC Evening News with Tom Brokaw. Unseemly though it may be, an ugly behind-the-scenes power play has come into focus, one in which NBC News chief, the celebrated Andrew Lack, has bitch-slapped anchorman Tom Brokaw in his own house. Brokaw revealed to correspondent Imus that he once tried to hire Andrew Lack as his Evening News executive producer, or in the terminology of TV journalism, his butt boy, in order to hold him down and to suppress any potential Mr. Lack might have to exceed Brokaw and thereby pose a threat.
Oh, sure.
Lack, ever savvy, ever insightful, a man who wears the title genius with grace and aplomb, rode through Brokaw like he was, well, Deborah Norville, and almost immediately became NBC News president, guiding the network to evening news supremacy despite the impediment of Brokaw. Well, that's unfortunate.
Yeah.
Let me rephrase that. Despite the obstacle Mr. Brokaw posed for ratings progress. That's better.
Yeah.
The Brokaw-Andy Lack relationship today, resentment, animus. The butt boy is on the other foot, so to speak.
Yeah.
And Tom's hollow but unctuously effusive praise of Mr. Lack's talents proves conclusively that, yes, he just can't stand it. My God, I love it so. And finally, tonight, these two words, food lion, and this phrase, ABC, dead. 5.5 million to Food Lion for the primetime live story that sucker punched the supermarket chain. World News Tonight ratings in free fall as America catches on to green card holder Peter Jennings.
Yeah.
And either abandoning or already off the foundering ABC, Cap City's Disney ship of state, White House correspondent Britt Hume, chief foreign correspondent Gary Eric Utley. Yeah. And Chief Info Babe, with a fine sweater meet, Diane Cia Sawyer. My prediction, in order to survive, even drastically diminished, ABC, the house that Roon built, will soon become a bordello. Much to the delight of Anchorman Jennings. For Media Watch, this is Walter Cronkite. Thank you and good night.
The potential for trouble from Bertha forced President Clinton to cancel a political trip to Florida this evening. Here in New York, our meteorologist, a resident hurricane expert, is Joe Witte, and he's tracking what now appears to be a wobble.
Well.
Trotter equipment is his choice of the world's finest health clubs, spas, and fitness facilities used by sports teams.
That lad on his might have too much.
I see a little silhouette of a man. Scaramouche, Scaramouche, will you do the fandango?
Ford, out in the Bronx with Muhammad Ali and Joe Frazier. I recall it.
You wrinkle up old Scott.
Yeah, I wish. I'm the star here. Yeah. Hey, Joe Frazier, you stupid yardie.
And Joe Frazier and Muhammad Ali.
How'd you go pick some cotton? You know, Tom?
I'll be fine, Muhammad.
If your radio sounds funny in the morning, you're listening to Imus in the morning.
From the NBA yesterday, they announced the 50 greatest players ever in the NBA. Mostly old-timers. There are some current players on the list.
Is so Len Bias on it?
No, Jack. No, Jack. Len Bias is not on it.
You got a good future ahead of you.
No, he doesn't have any future ahead of him. Jesus
Stop
Christ.
It. How about that dude with AIDS?
No, he's not on it either. This morning program.
No, today!
You're a jerk. You're a bald-headed Nazi. How's that?
You're a wrinkled-up old doofus.
What?
Pardon me? He said you're a wrinkled-up old doofus.
How would you like me to come in there and perspire on you? Huh?
Come on, bitch.
I don't think come on, bitch is the way you want to refer to your boss, do you?
If your radio sounds funny in the morning, you're listening to Imus in the morning.
What's that beeping sound, anyway? You the beeping?
No.
Yeah, I do. I mean, I was. Are you wearing a heart monitor or something?
No.
The batteries on your penis implant going bad? Imus
in the morning.
This is the Imus in the Morning radio program. It's 9 o'clock WFAN New York. Time for Imus in the Morning news and look at some of the headline stories. The program director,
well. That's true.
And the studio's hot.
Yep.
You know, you can't even get that fixed. All we're asking you to do is just get the studio cooled down. You don't have to straighten out the radio station.
Well, we had the air conditioner guy here yesterday afternoon for 3 hours.
Well, it didn't work, did it?
It leaks all over the place.
No.
Yeah.
Killing us.
Well, there was a fire here. That I had no control over.
And this criticism that Francesa is enduring is ludicrous. It's insanity.
Okay.
And for Francesa to, you know... For people to expect him to reveal this information that he's gotten from Parcells as a result of their friendship is insanity.
Well, the callers are always going to say one thing or another about that.
Oh,
let them say it. He's answered it as honestly as he can, and it's fine how he's answered the
question. Of course, one of the mistakes Mike makes is pretending to be privy to more information than he probably actually is. And so... Yeah, like he's
right. Some repository of all this.
He knows nothing.
Yeah,
he
knows a lot.
He knows a lot. But he doesn't play it well either. I mean, he should have from day one been up front about it. But the genesis of this current feud between these two goes back to the World Series and the Yankees winning the World Series, in which Mike supported the Yankees and Chris didn't. Hey, Chris is a sniveling little punk.
No, he's not.
He's not a good person.
Not.
You know he's not a good person.
No, he's
not a good person.
He's a good person.
He is not a good person. He is not a good person. And you know he's not.
Why do you say that?
Because he's not. Period. Because I've told him. He knows he's a little skunk. He's a disgraceful little skunk. Well, yeah. You must be sleeping with him or something.
And I'll tell you something else. The program sucks when you have this tension here. Nobody wants to listen to that. I mean, a certain amount of it sometimes is funny and amusing, but after a point, it's counterproductive. So it's not a good radio program anymore because you have, because Mike sits here, and part of it's Mike's fault too, because Mike sits here and sulks, you know.
He really hasn't been sulking the last couple of days.
Oh, okay. But do you listen?
Yes, I do, and he has not been sulking. Mike will tell you, because we talked about it, that I said on Monday I thought he was a little bit. And
he was sulking Monday. I told him that, but I said
it's absolutely been fine since then.
Yeah, well.
And he has. Get it straightened out. And Chris has been fine, too.
Get the studio cooled down. I mean, this is ridiculous. We'll put some tapes on and we'll go back and sleep.
You could take your jacket off, too.
Why should I take my jacket off? Why can't I be comfortable in here? Why can't you fix the heating situation here?
How about that?
And not tell me what clothes I ought to wear.
Yeah, what are you, crazy?
What are you, a wardrobe guy?
I'm sorry. I offended.
Well, get it fixed.
I will do my best.
Well, go.
Bring some beds.
There's nothing happening here with you on the air. You're killing us. Get the air conditioning fixed, you little weasel. Then go work on your NEWFM playlist.
Get some more Zeppelin.
more tall, more poco. God.
He's got two messes on his head.
Yeah, our program director here at the radio station in New York is also serving as a program director for WNEWFM, which is... I guess this week they're a classic rock station. They used to be a great rock and roll radio station,
absolutely.
And now they have about a one share, and
they bite.
They're almost unlistenable.
Yeah.
So he's been brought in by the Zen Master to try to straighten it out.
Sure. Emergency basis.
You know, so he sits back there in his office. Instead of listening to those two idiots in the afternoon to straighten that mess out.
Yeah, priority one.
He's back there trying to decide if he should follow Joe Walsh with the Doobies or the Eagles.
Mm-hmm. You know, too much Steely Dan.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, we're collapsing over here.
Yeah, unbelievable. Meanwhile, the radio station's going to hell in a handbasket, and he's worried about, you know, Joe Walsh.
The damn studio's hot.
Yeah. It's unbelievable.
Nothing chips.
Huh?
I wonder how this would fit here.
Yeah. It's 11 after the hour. Time for the national news. And here with that is Charles McCoy. Good morning, Chuck. So we got a real mess at the station here in New York.
It's horrible.
And generally, normally I like it, except that I think in this particular instance, it's just so outrageously inappropriate, all of it. And Russo is so hideously disloyal to the guy he works with that I wouldn't work with him if it were me. And if Frances had any guts, he wouldn't work with him.
Yep.
But apparently Frances is putting on a pair of them big old bloomer panties.
Yeah.
So,
it's ugly.
It is very ugly. And there's the tension just hangs in the air.
Oh,
here, like,
it's palpable. Absolutely.
Yeah. The radio station, a very unpleasant place to be.
Yeah.
So I don't mind that part of it, actually. By the way, the two guys come on after us here in New York, Russ Salzberg and Steve Summers, are not great friends either.
Oh, no way.
Bulletin.
So they hate each other. They don't hate each other, but...
Well, they
sit out in the newsroom and don't even look at each other.
Of course not.
So... And they make them work together, you know?
Sure, and you can feel it listening to them. You can feel it.
Oh.
They despise each other.
And Steve is thoroughly convinced that he's a lot smarter than Russ, which of course he is. And
well, he's thoroughly convinced he's a lot smarter than he is.
Yes, that's true.
Absolutely.
So, but
it's smarter than Russ. It's like saying you're the richest guy in Rwanda.
Not that
well, yeah.
Whoopsie damn do.
Yeah. But Russ has a certain charm, and
And Steve doesn't.
And Steve doesn't.
No.
So Steve's just an obnoxious geek. I like Russ.
There's kind of a comic side to Russ. Like, you know, like looking at a rodeo clown or something.
Little Gorsy kind of.
I like Steve too, frankly.
He's a sweet man. There's no doubt about that.
I like both of them.
Two good Jews.
But they really do dislike each other.
Yep. Dumb and dumber.
Yeah. But it's not the kind of abject hatred.
No.
And palpable tension that's going on in the afternoon, right?
No, they loathe each other, but you just
that's
don't
serious.
Get the sense of it.
Yeah. All right, 13 after the hour, and Chuck has a little news that's going on. For a couple of minutes, and now they're never speaking to him again. So. What do you know about the Terry Bradshaw was all over Fox yesterday. God, what a moron. Screaming about he had seen, Fox Sports had seen
Parcells' contract with the Patriots. And
when was the last time you confused Terry Bradshaw with Clarence Darrow? Okay. Okay. What would Terry do with the legal document that he saw, first of all? Okay.
Your radio sounds funny in the morning. You're listening to Imus in the morning.
Mad Dog is back on the phone.
Come on, Big D. I'm shocked at you. Green Bay went in here and killed him with speed. Speed, Donnie, speed.
Boy, am I going to have a ball today, 12 to 5.
I'm going to say, Mike, I'll go through homeroom one-on-one. You go through the losing coach of this hotel.
Sports, the Raiders have a new head coach, Joe Bugle, the man to lead the Oakland Raiders back to NFL prominence. But what's happened to the coaches of the NFL today? Here's Bugle's message to his players.
I'm not ashamed to tell our current football players I love them.
Just last week, Dick Vermeil, new head coach of the Rams, he had this to say.
I love my players.
What is going on today? Vince Lombardi rolling in his grave.
Bunch of moes.
Now here's Bugle on what he intends to do as coach of the Raiders.
I feel I have the opportunity to coach and help this football team learn how to play the game of professional football.
Did he ever box?
Sure. Sounds a little like
it. Sounds like he might have played a couple of years without a helmet, at least. Anyway.
Yeah. He's taking a shot.
I think they know how to play pro football.
Yeah. Didn't he coach the Cardinals at one time?
Yeah.
Now, earlier this week, new Saints coach Mike Ditka had this to say.
We're going to learn to run the football before we learn to pass it.
I guess they're going back to basics throughout the NFL with all these new coaches.
I really don't understand that. I don't know.
How these people get jobs as professional football players, and your initial goal is to teach them to play football.
Homeschooling.
Do you understand that?
Homeschooling.
Yeah.
At the old stadium.
I just don't understand. I really don't get it.
Bugle was asked, by the way, one more question. How will he coach?
Raider way.
The Raider way. Mm-hmm. Let Al Davis make all the decisions and run the team into the ground.
Yeah.
It's been the Raider way the past 10 years.
Yeah. Al, by the way, was asked if a Raider team will ever open things up with one of those new high-tech offenses.
It's like putting communism into the United States of America, or putting it into Western Europe, or putting capitalism into Russia. We're different.
I don't believe that I would have drawn that analogy, do you think?
I'd stay away from anything foreign affairs.
when we have a precipitous move in the former Soviet Union and a move toward democracy.
Yeah.
Jesus,
God almighty. And capitalism.
And capitalism.
Well,
I think God almighty.
Yeah,
can you be dumber than Al Davis is?
Well, of course not. Of course not.
Dennis Rodman expected to meet with NBA Commissioner David Stern today to discuss when his suspension will end.
What did you say?
There's your answer, Dennis Rodman. The Reverend Jesse Jackson recently spoke with Rodman, said Rodman's punishment was too severe, took away his dignity. Jesse loved the worm.
For the most part, he has done a good job, I think, in part because of the methods of Phil Jackson as coach, the way that Michael Jordan and Pippen have embraced him.
Jesse, big fan of the worm, hoping that the suspension will end soon.
Well, go away.
God, really, man. Well, that's sports. I'm Mike Breen.
All right. 1964, and you got the blues, baby.
Here now, taking advantage of the absolute very last outpost of visibility that'll have anything to do with him, American populist, Reform Party founder, and whining irritant, H. Ross Perot.
Larry, who do they think we are? Members of the Flat Earth Society or something? Bunch of idiots? Are you following this money deal in Washington? Disgraceful. Everybody says that the things going on aren't as bad as when Dick Nixon was president, right? Well, here's my question. If the fat boy from Arkansas just got the second scummiest administration anybody's ever seen, that means it's okay then? Let me go Ebonics on you, Larry. funk that. Yeah. Excuse me, but somebody's taking a whiz down my back and telling me it's raining. And his name is Lardbutt from a place called Hope. Yeah. Did you see his news conference the other day?
Oh, yeah.
He looks right at us, and says, straight-faced as a dead nun holding four of a kind, that 90% of the money his three-card Monte re-election campaign raised was raised in a perfectly lawful fashion. That there's a quote, Larry. How come not 100%? And what else? I only inhaled 90%. You can trust me 9 out of 10 times. I only showed Paula the 10% of me where my pecker is. And by the way, Larry, how come she isn't suing him in small claims court? You get it? Small claims. And here's something else I just love. He makes that big concession the other day, clasps his hand to his chest, goes all soft and gooey in the eyes, and says, mistakes were made. Sure as hell were. And the worst one was swearing him in again. I, Oleo Butt, do swear to kick Ken Starr's wrinkled rear. Or actually, to get Mike McCurry to do it for me. Because that nut will do or say anything. You ever heard anybody better at spinning jive than McCurry?
No.
Boy, could make a Muslim eat pork, couldn't he? And that slow fella, what's his name, Al Gore?
Yeah.
He's peddled more coffee than Starbucks, Larry. Host of 21 of those coffees at the White House that raised $27 million out of fat cats who expected nothing in return and never influenced a soul. Hell, Gore owes more favors than you do airplays left over from when you was a damn disc jockey. And here's the capper, Larry. After admitting mistakes were made and denying that the White House was for sale to anybody with a gripe and a platinum card, our first hypocrite goes off to a fundraiser full of stogie-smoking masters of the universe who paid $10,000 apiece to meet him. Somebody selling me number 9 sandpaper and calling it toilet tissue. It's just that simple. He keeps calling himself the education president, floating this idea and that to try to throw us off the track. Wanted to put all them high school girls in those little uniforms. Remember that?
Sure.
Okay, here's an education bumper sticker for you to get out of here on. My president just knocked up your honor student. But it was an accident, Larry. He was only trying to f*** the country. And you can use that for your soundbite. Or you can just bite me. Much obliged for having me on your show. And let the hearings begin.
I'm talking with Mike Wallace from CBS News.
What is this Mr. Wallace routine?
Well, because I have enormous respect for you.
Well, you may call me Mike.
Oh, okay, thank you.
Yeah, Don. In any case. I cannot bring myself to say, I'm Ann. I mean,
yeah,
it sounds so stupid.
It does sound stupid.
And it sounds really stupid when you say it.
If your radio like sucks in the morning, you're listening to I Miss in the Morning.
Once I just brief you a little politics of it.
Sure.
Well, yesterday we had...
How long am I on? About
as long as you want to be. So.
Until you fall asleep.
Yeah. Thank you so much.
I got the parallax, Snoop got it going on, so y'all can just relax. Like Santa Claus to his little elf, Snoop Dogg thumb large, and he licking himself. But word up, I don't roll over and beg. But if the bitch be fine, I'll be humping her leg. Got the crack, the smack, paid for my Cadillac. I'm black, don't get whacked or I get out my mat. Representing gangster style, I'm a cap popping lifer. Shut up, sit down, Snoop is holding a cipher. Latest statistics show that 1 in 7 black men can't vote because they're convicted felons. Once they put your ass away, a brother ain't got no say in the everyday American way. Even if society's dead, you already repaid. But the numbers ain't gonna really be abated. So laws are 7 times more likely to be incarcerated. Black man ain't got no chance at no truth when there's a white only sign stuck on a voting booth. Courtroom still in deep denial. If they think race ain't an issue in the O.J. Simpson trial, for a conviction all that need is 9 to 3. Tell me how many white folk on the jury can you see? How's he supposed to get a trial by his peers when they don't take the murderers for volunteers? The defense still making the claim that the juice was a victim of a frame and that LAPD should take the blame. But if the shoe fits him, that's the end of the game. And he can run like the Energizer Bunny. But sooner or later, he got to come up with some money. Even if he took a knife to his own wife's throat, O.J. ain't a convicted felon, so at least he can vote. Shoot upside the head. Smack his wife upside the head. Shoot upside the head. Smack his wife upside the head. Big Snoop upside your head. Big Snoop upside your head.
Now listen, Sapphire, how would you like to come home every day and find a no-good bum laying around the house?
Well, what you think I've been doing for 22 years?
Hello, Warner Wolf here.
I'm Warner, the general manager.
Well, Ted.
And we're back. 718-937-6666 is our telephone number. Richard Neer. Susan Waldman will join us in her normal spot a little bit later on this hour. Talk to her about the Knicks and very little Yankee news. Not a lot of things happening in Yankee land this week, but we'll touch on whatever is going on. And, of course, we'll talk basketball with her. But up until then, we probably will devote our time to the tuna, all the time, here on The Fan, 718-937.
From the flagship station for New York Rangers hockey.
Saturday morning in New York. Nice to have you with us. Talking about the world of sports, 718-937-6666. Good to have you with us. The first day of February, 1997, with our buddy Mike Hayes and Sweeney Murdy across the way as we chat about what's cooking. And I'm sure the whole jet scenario will be part of the issue today, as will J.D. about the Rangers and...
You're kidding. Number three.
Well,
half of your audience lives in a trailer.
If your radio sounds funny in the morning, you're listening to Imus in the Morning.
By the way, do you know what a North Carolina divorce and a tornado have in common?
No.
Somebody's going to lose a mobile home.
Imus in the Morning.
Once upon a time you dressed so fine, you knew the bums a dime in your prime, didn't you? My voice is gone, man. You want to try it again?
Imus in the Morning.
This is the Imus in the Morning radio program. It's 7 o'clock, WFAN New York. Time for Imus in the Morning News.
Why do you think it's taken the O.J. jury so long to come up with a verdict?
I don't know.
He killed them people. How hard is this? All you got to do is figure out how much money you're going to force them to pay. Ain't no Mensa members on no juries, Mr. Chump, that's for sure. Or in the armed services either, for that matter.
Critic, bro.
Don't make me laugh. This tub of pudding going into the Marines? They're going to have to change their slogan to the few, the proud, the brain damaged. Buying a beret and a loaf of French bread because he know he going to Paris Island. The first time his drill sergeant says, drop and give me 20, Riddick going to get down on his knees, pull out a 10 and 2 fives. He said going into the Marines was a lifelong dream. What happened? He finally answered one of them phones that have been constantly ringing in his head since his last fight? This boy must know his brain cells by name.
Well,
how is standing at attention in 100 degree heat with a fat white guy screaming in your face a lifelong dream?
No.
Going into the armed forces is like going to prison. Got a bunch of guys in funny hats treating you like dirt, making you wear a drab colored uniform like everybody else, doing menial jobs for no money, sleeping in the same giant room with a bunch of other guys, showering with them. The Marines are looking for a few good men? Yeah, well, so are most of the inmates in the joint. They must have relaxed their standards years ago, right around the time they let you in. I have a hard time picturing some John Wayne type of CO calling Private Imus into his office to discuss what he thought about John Foster Dulles. I guess that must have been a pretty seminal period in your life, though, Mr. Chum, because didn't you used to blow the bugle in the Marines?
Among other things, yes.
Come over here, sailor.
Going to Albuquerque, New Mexico, here to La Posada Hotel. Which is house of... Where's that hotel you are?
The Double Men?
It's not the Double Men. How is that?
It's just fine.
Is it?
It's every hotel you've ever been in your life.
Bernard, how many stop sets have we done?
We've done one so far, I imagine.
Okay.
Hey, so, Breen, pass me those pigs in a blanket, please.
If your radio sounds funny in the morning, You're listening to Imus in the Morning.
We have a guy standing outside the, he looks like an intelligent fellow, doesn't he?
Oh, yeah.
There with a, Jesus, God, man, oh, man. Looks like the things a bridesmaid wore when I got married. Remember those things
no,
with hoods they had?
No, we don't need any crack this morning. Thank you.
On the WB. Don't miss...
And Highway Patrol.
Ernest in the Morning. Trying to watch with my daddy.
Base it against Johnson. Left front. Back in. He's in the paint and spins to the baseline. Layup. Bank shot. It's good and a foul.
Mason gyrating, vibrating underneath the left side. Bedeviling LJ.
Anthony Mason and the Hornets sting the Knicks.
Good morning.
Yeah,
Mike
after
Prince
the game, Paul. Mason sucking and jiving. Should be moving and grooving to his parole officer.
I'll be fine, Clyde.
Well, Clyde Frazier with the analysis. This sportscast sponsored by your local Toyota dealer. The Knicks' 15-game home win streak comes to an end. 99-93 loss to the Hornets. Former Knick Anthony Mason glad to beat his old team. And Mace was in a fine mood when he appeared on WFAN's postgame show with Susan Wallman.
Let's go right down and bring in an old friend. He was 5-for-8 tonight, 11 rebounds, 3 assists, 2 steals, and a block, 13 points. And that, of course, is our old buddy, Anthony Mason. How you doing, Mace?
Hey, doing fine. How's everything?
Everything's fine. And I guess...
Okay.
You want to give us a little love boat here on the air?
The love boat.
Good to have Mace back in town.
No, he's not enjoying beating the Knicks 3 out of 4 times this year.
I'm very happy for Mace.
One of the good guys, Anthony Mason.
Absolutely.
Yeah. He is now.
Okay.
My man.
Other NBA scores, Jordan scores 45. Bulls beat the Sonics in Seattle. Boston losing at home to the Vancouver Grizzlies by 10. NFL news, Bill Parcells still doesn't have a team to coach, but he has a new product to endorse. According to today's New York Post business section, Parcells will be the pitch man for casual male, big and tall, a chain of apparel stores. Of course, he's endorsed products in the past like SlimFast, so Bill's still a hot item.
How about the Wonder Bra? Your moose.
Man.
Jimmy. Was that press conference? I mean, was that the...
Oh, for Brian.
I mean, that was just disgraceful, wasn't it?
Just end it.
I don't mind.
Who cares what you're doing?
Really, honest to God. Who cares?
Who cares?
For crying out loud in the final, who cares what Bill Parcells is going to do?
Sit down.
I don't put any money in my pocket. Jeez.
I mean, it was
on
just...
On and on. Like, it was the declaration of the Ninth World War is on it.
And by the way, can't you see that Bob Kraft is pretty much a little creep?
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, you can see that.
Well, that doesn't come across.
No. No, I didn't get that at all.
No.
I'd
like to work for him.
Oh, my God.
Speaking of press conferences, Jim Kelly had his this past weekend. Kelly retiring as Bills quarterback after 11 years.
At this time, I'm officially announcing my retirement from the NFL and as a quarterback of the Buffalo Bills.
Very tough to get through for Jimbo.
Is he going
to
do manage a Stuckey's on I-87? Idiot.
I mean.
He should have hung on for as many years as possible. Dope.
He's fine. I mean, here's what I don't know. Well, I don't know. I guess.
What?
I guess when it comes time to step up to the microphone, it's apparently emotional. I don't know what it is, but I mean, I just
come
get
on.
Out.
Oh, it's crying, crying again.
Yeah.
You're going to leave me.
Just get out.
I can see that far away look in your eyes. I can tell by the way you hold me, darling, that it won't be long before it's crying time.
Time to see the morning.
The whole world thinks I'm just a painter. They all want me, they can't get me. Hey, Baba Clinton, why don't you bite me? Remove me, can't stop me. I gotta go to make love with you. To the east, to the east, who could not be profaner? It's a camel hump and heathen, not a Saddam Hussein. Doing a dance that they call a Lacarena. Hey, Lacarena. Saddam Hussein is an insane dictator. Tries to throw his weight around, but he's just a second rater. Soon where he stands, there will only be a crater. Hey, I'm not worried about your power. He don't think that I mean business. I don't like him, couldn't stand him. And his wife, well, now that's one woman who should be wearing a veil. Maybe the great Satan can show her a thing or two about what it is to be subservient.
East in the east, who could not be profaner? Is a camel hop and heathen or a Sahara Hussein? Doing the dance that they call a Ragarena. Hey, Ragarena. Sahara Hussein is an insane dictator. Tries to throw his weight around, but he's just a second rater. Soon where he stands, there will only be a crater.
Until you start paying 15 bucks a gallon for gas. Come and get me, my name's Saddam Hussein, and I can make it any better. I'm big cheese on your knees, and I'll do what I damn well please.
East in the east, who could not be profaner? Is a camel hop and heathen, not a Saddam Hussein. Doing the dance that they call a Ragarena. Hey, Ragarena. Saddam Hussein is an insane dictator. Tries to throw his weight around, he's just a second rater. Soon where he stands, there will only be a crater. Hey, Ragarena.
U.S. Attorney Sherry Petucci is urging us not to believe what we may have heard about the state of Montana.
In fact, Montana is a state where law and order is highly prized and is not a haven for criminals.
It is a place, lady, where people have sex with sheep. Because I've been there and done that. Don't try to run that drive by us.
Sex with a sheep?
Absolutely.
You the eye man?
Yeah.
They don't jabber at you afterwards.
You know? Yeah, you don't have to hold them till they go to sleep.
Your radio sounds funny in the morning. You're listening to Imus in the morning.
The only drawback is you have to walk so far to kiss them.
And you end up with a nice sweater.
Dennis from Boston. Good morning, Dennis.
Hi, buddy. Every now and then you think I'm drunk, don't you?
Yes, you sound drunk all the time.
Yeah, well, I'm not today.
Okay.
I'm coming down there with a caravan.
They're not coming down anywhere. You don't do it, old fool. You don't do anything. I'll have you arrested and pistol whip you. Dennis.
Wait, you're a little slow today, Amy.
So you
are. A little slow?
Your radio sounds funny in the morning. You're listening to Imus in the morning.
Hey, Charles, what does it mean when that light is flashing on the back of a cab? Does it mean they're being held up?
That means a goat needs help.
At 7, every last outpost of visibility that'll have anything to do with him, American populist, Reform Party founder, and whining irritant, H. Ross Perot.
Larry, who do they think we are? Members of the Flat Earth Society or something? Bunch of idiots? Are you following this money deal in Washington? Disgraceful. Everybody says that the things going on aren't as bad as when Dick Nixon was president, right? Well, here's my question. If the fat boy from Arkansas just got the second scummiest administration anybody's ever seen, that means it's okay then? Let me go Ebonics on you, Larry. Funk that. Excuse me, but somebody's taking a whiz down my back and telling me it's raining. And his name is Lardbutt from a place called home. Did you see his news conference the other day?
Oh, yeah.
He looks right at us, and says, straight-faced as a dead nun holding four of a kind, that 90% of the money his three-card Monty re-election campaign raised was raised in a perfectly lawful fashion. That there's a quote, Larry. How come not 100%? And what else? I only inhaled 90%. You can trust me 9 out of 10 times. I only showed Paula the 10% of me where my pecker is. And by the way, Larry, how come she isn't suing him in small claims court? You get it? Small claims.
Shut up.
And here's something else I just love. He makes that big concession the other day, clasps his hand to his chest, goes all soft and gooey in the eyes, and says, mistakes were made. Sure as hell were. And the worst one was swearing him in again. I, Oleo Butt, do swear to kick Ken Starr's wrinkled rear. Or actually, to get Mike McCurry to do it for me. Because that nut will do or say anything. You ever heard anybody better at spinning jive than McCurry?
No.
Boy could make a Muslim eat pork, couldn't he? And that slow fella, what's his name, Al Gore?
Yeah.
He's peddled more coffee than Starbucks, Larry. Host of 21 of those coffees at the White House that raised $27 million out of fat cats who expected nothing in return and never influenced a soul. Hell, Gore owes more favors than you do airplays left over from when you was a damn disc jockey. And here's the capper, Larry. After admitting mistakes were made and denying that the White House was for sale to anybody with a gripe and a platinum card, our first hypocrite goes off to a fundraiser full of stogie-smoking masters of the universe who paid $10,000 apiece to meet him. Somebody selling me number 9 sandpaper and calling it toilet tissue. It's just that simple. He keeps calling himself the education president, floating this idea and that to try to throw us off the track. Wanted to put all them high school girls in those little uniforms. Remember that?
Sure.
Okay, here's an education bumper sticker for you to get out of here on. My president just knocked up your honor student. But it was an accident, Larry. He was only trying to f*** the country. And you can use that for your soundbite. Or you can just bite me. Much obliged for having me on your show. And let the hearings begin.
Here's Scott from Tucson, Arizona. And I like it. Morning, Scott.
I love you, man, but what are you becoming, the president's personal water boy now, or what's the deal here?
Did you come see me when I was in Tucson?
No, I couldn't. I had to go to a funeral back in Iowa.
Would have been the same thing, really.
It
would
have been like a wake, actually.
Shut up.
Check the lips were moving.
If your radio light sucks in the morning, you're listening to Imus in the Morning.
We'd now like to welcome to the Imus in the Morning program, Pat O'Brien from CBS Sports, who just flew in from L.A. Good morning, Pat.
Yeah. Morning, Don. Good morning, Charles. Just getting my headphones on here.
All right. What do you think of this phone?
You're handing me your phone. Let me put it up next to my Ericsson here. How much memory on this? How many names can you put in?
500.
So, what do you got? Charles Bernard and 498 doctors?
Imus in the Morning.
Sports
with
my daddy.
Time for an Imus in the Morning exclusive. Good morning. This is Mike Breen with Sports. WFAN in New York has learned that Bill Belichick will be named head coach of the New York Jets later today. Belichick's been Bill Parcells' defensive coordinator in New England and New York, also a head coach with the Cleveland Browns. Belichick, not a dynamo with the media, but he's a heck of a coach. And in an exclusive phone interview this morning, I talked to Belichick.
Good morning, Bill. I'm sorry to wake you so early this morning, but I was just wondering, how does it feel to be the new coach of the Jets?
Well, I'm pretty excited. I'm thrilled. I know the team sucks, but at least it's a head coaching job, you know? Quite frankly, I'm kind of tired of being Parcells' toady. So I'm real happy.
Surprisingly candid comments from Belichick. Again, press conference later today. He'll be named head coach of the New York Jets.
Not Bill Leno, that's for sure.
Patriots, of course, have a new coach. It's Pete Carroll, who already has a special relationship with owner Bob Kraft.
I would like to say how grateful I am to become part of Robert Kraft's family.
Yes, he has been adopted by the Kraft family in addition to being the head football coach of the Patriots.
Yeah, right,
so all these jobs filling up.
Yeah.
In boxing, they held a press conference yesterday for the May 3rd rematch between Mike Tyson and Evander Holyfield. Here's Holyfield.
Thank the Lord for the opportunity.
Here we go. Fine. Meanwhile, here's Mike Tyson.
What's the matter with that?
Why can't he thank the Lord?
He can, of course.
He said every time he opens his mouth, he's thanking him.
Well, that's fine. He's a very spiritual guy.
Michael seems to have a problem with that.
Yeah, I have a big problem with that.
on several occasions.
He's not raping women.
Yeah, God loves a baby Jesus.
All right, speaking of raping women.
Beating his wife up.
Snatching purses.
Yeah, that's right.
Not raping somebody.
Sure.
I just don't like when people are wearing it on their sleeve. That's
well,
all.
That's fine. You just don't worry about
yeah.
it. Just expressing my opinion.
I'm just thanking the Lord, and I'm thanking the Lord when I'm going to be thanking the Lord when you're done.
Speaking as Bernard says, speaking of raping women, here's Mike Tyson.
Oh, my belief and theory in life is to destroy or be destroyed. And I'm looking forward to destroy.
Oh, you're not going to do it.
Yeah.
Nobody wants to play rhythm guitar behind Jesus.
Yeah.
Everybody wants to be the lead singer in the band.
Valentine's Day.
Morning, Mr. Lubica.
I'd like to sign up for the Don Imus Federal Work Release Celebrity Tour, please.
You know, that's going to be great. After about 2 days, there'll be more violence with people trying to bust out Arizona than there is in that new movie, The Rock.
Have you ever been to the Scottsdale Princess?
Yes, I have.
It's a pretty odd place, isn't it?
It's a great place. Halloween party, too, huh?
Yeah, the Hate Radio Rodeo.
Oh, God, yeah, cancel my tickets to the World Series. You know, you're moving up on a Carnival Cruise Line thing, aren't you? Come on, you and Deirdre, you know, hanging over the deck there.
Well, honey, it doesn't get any better than this, does it?
Your radio sounds fun, Marty. You're listening to Imus in the Morning.
Hey, by the way,
yeah.
Did I hear you suggesting yesterday that you might give away part of your inheritance to a caller?
Yes.
Okay, well, listen, don't hang up today. I'll just hold, okay?
You get a stroke, are you, Pat?
No, I'm not, Don. How are you?
Don't worry about how I am.
Butt out.
Yeah, butt out.
Butt out.
Yeah.
Ass white. It's a pleasant phone call.
Pardon me?
This is a pleasant phone call. By the way, you know the Barnacle bus?
Yeah.
I saw Robert W. Morgan driving it out of town with Rick Dees and Mark and Brian.
I did.
After that 2-hour interview with Bernadette Castro.
We're not concerned about all that.
Now they're getting on a plane.
Yeah.
What's next, Babe Buchanan for 90 minutes?
Is this a critical phone call?
No, it's a congratulations for one great week in L.A.
Shut up.
We love having you here. And by the way...
Yeah.
Are you and Katzenberg really in a fight?
Yeah. Get him back on the phone.
Good morning. Mike Brain with sports. Riddick Bowe, losing his heavyweight bout badly to Andrew Galata last night, was awarded the decision when Galata disqualified in the 7th round for continuous low blows. A sound decision by the referees. But then Bowe's people reacted in a disgusting and disgraceful fashion, storming the ring, going at Galata, hit over the head with a walkie-talkie. Someone reportedly went at him with a scissors. And then there was Lou Duva, knocked down, lying in a stretcher. Someone stole a ring right off his finger.
Jeez. Here's the most distressing aspect of all of this, is we are able to get on this program everybody from the president. Well, no, not the president.
No.
But
no.
Everybody from...
Yes.
Not everybody else, with the exception of the president.
That's exactly right, I mean.
Who now no longer will speak to me, and who could blame him?
And that is right.
And, but Rock Newman blew me off this morning and would refuse to appear on the program. And no one has been more accommodating to this geek than I have.
Nobody.
Here's another thing, O'Brien.
Yeah.
Jeffrey Katzenberg and I and Charles, we've all been friends for 20 years.
Right.
So,
by the way, now you know you have a real phone number for me, but go ahead.
And Mr. Katzenberg is one of the best people I know. He is a genuinely charming, funny, nice person.
Right. And a gentleman.
And a gentleman.
Square shooter. A great guy.
Yes. The problem is we felt obligated to take sides in his battle with Michael Eisner.
Well, I would have sided with Jeffrey. Go ahead.
Okay. Well, of course you would, because you're a fraidy cat, scaredy baby.
Certainly.
And plus you think that sometime you might want to write a screenplay.
And you're out there.
And you're out there in L.A., and you're a typical L.A. suck-up. Our position is give back the mouse stuff you stole. That's one. Get your own fax stationery. Stop whining about the money and make a movie. Make a movie. That's our position.
How hard is this?
Now,
well, I have to like the Eisner side, too, so...
Well, of course you do.
Yeah.
So
So you don't think... drag me into this.
You don't... This has been a great week of radio.
Yeah, it's been actually a lot of fun, haven't you? And by the way, I finally did read that calendar piece.
Yeah.
But I was going to suggest to you that now that you're in L.A., you lie about your age, but I see you already have lied about your age.
No, I haven't.
What did 60 Minutes say you were?
What did they say I was?
Well,
what did they say I was?
54.
80. Oh, they said I was 52.
52?
Yeah.
52. Oh, I thought they said 56.
No, well, I am 52.
You're 55.
No, I'm not. 52.
The L.A. Times said you were 55.
Well, they're wrong.
Screwed up.
The L.A. Times is wrong. I'm 52 years old. In about 10 days, I'll be 53.
So now I'm not supposed to believe the L.A. Times, 60 Minutes, Michael Eisner, or Jeffrey Katzenberg?
No. And I wouldn't want this. I wouldn't want you to think that Mr. Katzenberg and my relationship has been severed. Quite the contrary.
No.
The difference is I don't want anything from Jeffrey.
Need anything.
And I don't need anything from him. I like him as a friend. I'm not going to ever do a screenplay. I'm not going to ever be in a movie. Nor do I want. I'm not going to ever be on television. I have no intention of any of that.
The only thing you need in L.A. right now is listeners. And that'll come.
And a funny guest.
That would help. The only two people in L.A. we know are you and Katzenberg.
That's pretty good.
Katzenberg's angry, and you're a loser. You're not bringing anything to the table. And then you're calling up with a snippy phone call about, why don't you go listen to Rick Dees and or Mark and Brian if they're so wonderful.
Well, let me just...
All three of little Imus rip-off punks anyway.
That's it.
Go listen to that little dirty mouth Howard Stern.
Right.
I don't mind if you listen to Morgan because I love Morgan.
Yeah. Why did you call me back?
I don't know.
Well, the good thing about this is for you folks in L.A., in 2 weeks, this will be the best of Imus.
As for Rock Newman last night, he was upset when the fight was stopped, but he should have been ecstatic because his fighter was taking a whooping. Galata dominating the bout, but he spoiled his chance for the biggest victory of his life with nonstop.
You got a piece of toast in your mouth?
You should talk for crying out loud. Just be quiet. Let me do this, please.
Nice sore on your lip. That'll look great on the Olympics.
Nice sore on your face.
Only about a billion people are going to be watching you, Mike.
You should talk with all the sores you've had all over your body.
Yeah, at least his are on his lips.
Please continue.
Rock Newman explains his actions.
When I saw it just explode, I mean, it just exploded. I mean, I was excited, and I was yelling at Galata. I mean, it was uncalled for.
You were the one who got in the ring, a little lion.
Absolutely. Weasel. Led the charge.
As I said before, Imus, this clearly was a Newt Gingrich-White conspiracy to discredit Riddick Bowe, Marion Barry, and the Washington District of Columbia, Imus. And let me tell you something, Imus. We were clearly on the verge of a classic rope-a-dope when this Polish princess kept assaulting Big Daddy's genitalia, Imus, and I was outraged. Gelato was about to be knocked out, Imus.
Well,
and did you see Gelato try to headbutt one of my boys' walkie-talkies, Imus?
If Mr. Gelato was about to be knocked out, he was going to have to knock himself out.
That's right.
Because a Riddick Butterbean Big Daddy Bo wasn't going to get it done.
He was about to go down.
Yeah. Riddick Deese did say afterwards that he wants a rematch. No, he doesn't.
Uh-huh. No, sir.
Plus, he wants another ass-whooping.
That's right.
And that's sports I might bring. Do we need Pat O'Brien calling up and dissing the I-Man?
Well, no. That's not what you were seeking.
Put the I-Man on the spot. And by the way, you know, if people in Los Angeles want to listen, fine. And if they don't, that's fine.
Of course. Cutter. That's why they make dials.
And that's the reason we have people. The show business is full of people like our friend Pat O'Brien,
mm-hmm.
who are so concerned about what everybody thinks when we just don't care.
No.
Boys, bum me out.
Yeah. All right, let's work him over a little bit, man.
This is really... And what's great is he's going to have to wait 3 hours in L.A. to hear this.
But he will.
Of course he will be somewhere. Because he has nothing to do, obviously.
Blow-drying is there.
Yeah. Well, he has left of it.
No, I mean hair singular.
No.
Blow-drying is one.
Stand by, Pat. There he is, boss.
Why did you feel it was necessary to call me up and bum me out?
I didn't call to bum you out. I was trying to be funny and pleasant.
What better radio program is there on in Los Angeles than this one?
I'm not trying to bum you out.
What better radio program is there?
Answer the question.
There's nothing better.
Well, does Mark and Brian play Pearl Jam?
Don, there's nothing better. Are you that insecure now?
Well, no, but I'm your...
I could bum you out?
Yes.
Well, you're doing great. I actually called to say you're doing great this week. How's that?
I don't believe you.
No, that's weak.
Because you're an insincere, typical, a little weaselly
Hollywood.
Showbiz worm with, by the way, fat little stubby truck driver hands.
I'm glad I answered this phone again.
Let me tell you something right now. You, for whatever reason, you do not have artistic hands. Are you aware of that?
Your wife loves my hands.
My wife hates you, but your hands and every other part of your body.
She does?
Yeah.
Get her on the phone. Do you have a number for her?
What's Anthony Mason's number again?
No, it was a call of congratulations. And why does everything have to be funny? Why does everything have to be controversial? Can't we just talk and bond?
Can't we all get along?
Why don't we get along? News.
Don't get Mariner. Go get in your car and speed down some L.A. street till it cuts beat the hell out of you.
It's a Jeep. The only way to beat the hell out of me is if I have an Imus bumper sticker.
Today,
I'd like Bernard to butt out.
Yeah, butt out here, okay?
And be respectful to Mr. Francesa,
Bernard. That's exactly right, Donnie. You know what I want you to do?
What?
Instead of asking me about the game,
yeah.
Why don't you ask Coach Parcells about the game?
Where is he?
How you doing, Don?
Good morning, Coach.
Ooh. Hey, listen.
Yeah.
Since you've been on that TV, you know, once in a while now, I get to see you.
Yeah.
I was looking at that hair color.
Yeah.
You know?
It's my
Listen,
hair color, Coach.
There's a couple of my friends in Jersey that have 1948 Mercury's, the same color as your hair.
That's
is that cherry red metallic we got?
If your radio light sucks in the morning, you're listening to Imus in the Morning.
I'm a huge fan, Coach, and by the way, I'm picking you to win this game.
Yeah. Well, I'm sure my players will rest easy knowing that.
An intensely intimate examination of various media cavities by the Dean of Press Probers Media Monitor, Walter Cronkite.
Return with me now to Tuesday, January 28th, 1997, and bend over. A day like all days, filled with events that disgust.
Right.
Spread before us today, an unsettling phenomenon that has taken root on the unjustifiably successful Imus in the Morning radio program.
What?
And its simulcast television outlet, MSNBC. Carries it not because of the quality of its content, but because it was the cheapest morning program that a tin cans and string cable network with no appeal, no audience, and no hope could get. Despite that, an inexplicable pattern has developed involving the program's host, Don Imus. For reasons that stupefy this old oracle of the ominous, guests who appear on the Imus show ascribe to the man, who's basically an unlettered and superficial ignoramus, a near godlike significance. Time and again, respected people resign their ethics, their values, and standards to curry favor with a figure who might best be described as a clod with clout, who acquired celebrity through serendipity. The most conspicuous manifestation of fawning, servile sycophancy by Imus's guests is wearing items from his brother's mail-order clothing concern, the Auto Body Express. Well, the most recent example, Tuesday the 28th, no less a figure than Jack Valenti, chairman and CEO of the Motion Picture Association, special assistant to presidents, a man of international stature, appearing on the Imus program in a f***ing Fred shirt. And compounding this felony of fawning, addressing the host of the program as I-Man.
Well,
pathetic.
Yeah.
And yet Mr. Valenti is hardly alone in contemptible behavior. Indeed, he joins an obsequious pantheon who genuflected before. Paul Begala, who sought the approbation of Imus to the point of appearing on the Larry King show in a Fred shirt. Bob Dole, so desperate for Imus's favor that during that horrid man of the people phase, he wore a Fred shirt before tens of thousands of unwashed goobers at the Charlotte Motor Speedway.
Yeah.
Dan Rather, Fred shirt, Fred tie, and a continual stream of embarrassingly adoring notes of gratitude to Imus for allowing him to appear on the program. Bill Clinton, still maintaining a turquoise buffalo hat among his jogging attire. Pat O'Brien, America's second favorite house guest after Cato Kalin, so racked with need to win the slightest attention from Imus that he's had a Fred shirt bonded to his skin. We could go further, to the Tim Russerts, Jeff Greenfields, Mary Matlins, and on and on. Well, here's the reality. America is sucking up to an individual who pees in phone booths, who expresses himself in convolutions that make Ebonics scholars sound like understudies for Hamlet, who once single-handedly caused a supply-side crisis in the vodka industry, and who, in marrying, didn't rob the cradle, he robbed the incubator. Allow me to say, stop the madness, for your idol is an idiot. An idiot whose unmerited success is the sort of random accident that proves conclusively there is no God. Memo then to Madeline Murray O'Hare. You can come out now, and probably wearing your Auto Body Express t-shirt. For me to watch, this is Walter Cronkite. Thank you and good night.
1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3.
You know those...
There's someone in program.
This is Pratticelli's a joke, man.
Why?
Why?
I mean, he asked O.J. if he did it. O.J. Said he didn't do it. So where do you go from there?
Well, he also said he didn't hit her.
So that means he killed her?
It could lead the jury to believe that if he's not telling the truth about hitting her, maybe he's not telling the truth about killing her.
We don't
need to talk to Jack Ford, Charles. We have an idiot on the phone now.
If your radio sounds funny in the morning... You're listening to Imus in the morning.
Jury consultant Joe Ellen Demetrius says the civil trial jurors are watching O.J.'s every step.
This jury is looking at everything, and they're not just watching him in the stand. They're watching him as he walks into the courtroom.
Ah, Laura, you're watching your bosoms.
You're watching, baby.
Just shut up, Bernard, you animal.
Jeez.
You're watching your bosom.
I mean, Jesus, God.
What I'm talking about.
Imus in the morning.
Coming up on the next...
What's with Mark Breen?
I've decided what I want to do with the rest of my professional career. You know, you go through kind of a time where you have like a little coaching, I don't want to use the word menopause, but I would guess that might be it.
Bill Parcells' minstrel cycle returns him to Gotham.
God, these football coaches. God.
Jeez.
Buy a vocabulary book.
Good morning.
This about midlife crisis.
Look, my breasts are bigger today.
Oh, God.
For Mike Breen with sports sponsored by your local Toyota dealer. So here's the setup. I'm Miss Parcells, head coach of the Jets in 98, a trusted advisor next season. Bill Belichick, the coach for 97. The media with the head of Team Tuna on Tuesday.
Bill, what would make any Jet fan think you are committed to the long haul based on your track record of bailing out on franchises?
What was the question?
An inquiry of sorts from WFAN's Chris Russo.
The person who asked that question, I don't know who it is, but my contract has expired here in New England.
Did it expire with the Giants twice, Bill?
Here's my question. Did he bail out on the Giants?
I do not know whether he has physically broken a contract or not, but there have been rumors to the fact that he has negotiated or talked to other teams long under contract.
But that's quite different than a history of bailing out on franchises.
Yes.
Yeah. A history of bailing out on franchises.
I don't know whether he's bailed out on franchises or broken contract.
Which is why Chris Russo has no credibility, because he asks a stupid, confrontational question based on no fact, based on simply rumors. There's a much better way to ask that question. But, I mean, he's not a very smart guy, and which is the reason that the television thing didn't work out and the book thing didn't work out. And he's barely hanging on to a job with Francesca, and if it weren't for Francesca, he wouldn't have a job.
Like the picture of the kitten to come.
I mean,
hanging on by the...
You know, when is it going to occur to this guy when the TV thing doesn't work, the Mad Dog Minutes don't work, the book doesn't work? You know, and I had to waste my time writing an introduction for his book that they won't publish. I'd have sent him a bill for that. And by the way, the introduction I wrote was better than his book.
So, I mean, he's a disgraceful old jerk.
But, you know, good thing Parcells didn't know who it was who asked it, but just an insipid question. I understand what his point was. But, you know, we're coming up on 26 at the hour.
I took one look and I was fractured. I tried to work, but I was lame. I tried to talk, but I just stuttered. Why, what's your name?
What's your name?
What's your name?
I'm a in the morning.